Funding for Georgia Outdoors has been made possible in part by grants from the Georgia Natural Resources Foundation, from the Imlay Foundation, and from viewers like you.
Imagine if you found a passenger pigeon in your backyard. There used to be millions in the United States, but they were listed as extinct in 1914. Yet, here you have this bird in your backyard that isn't even supposed to exist. What would you do? This is a story about how, when it comes to nature, you can't take anything for granted.
Jimmy Evans is a superstar in the world of fish ecology. He may not be a household name in your circles, but in the close-knit community of biologists, Jimmy is well known. He does what so many researchers do, sampling rivers for fish to determine what's out there, or perhaps more importantly, what is not. His team goes up and down the water, sending out an electric current that shocks the fish and allows them to examine the species in Georgia rivers. It is tedious work, long days. But on that boat, Jimmy Evans found something that changed his life forever.
You know, we knew what fish were supposed to be in the Oconee River, and we knew these definitely weren't supposed to be there.
This fish was not in any of his identification manuals. He tried to match this newfound fish with every possible species. Nothing looked even close to what they brought in that day.
He began to think about the possibility of something. Was it introduced? Is it an exotic? The last thing that comes to your mind is it's native and nobody knows about it. I mean, that's the least likely thing that comes to your mind. So basically, we were at a standstill. We didn't know where to go. We had a fish that we couldn't identify, that we knew it shouldn't be here, but it was here.
That was in 1991. They knew that they had a sucker, a bottom-feeding fish. Now it's called the robust redhorse. At the time, it was an unknown, not in any guidebook. Samples were sent to experts like Bud Freeman at the University of Georgia.
Essentially, this fish took a great deal of detective work on the parts of many people.
Right. Well, actually, the robust redhorse was lost to history. It was literally buried in history. We had them, we knew they were different. We still didn't know it was the robust redhorse yet, all right? It was just this undescribed fish that was big, and we were excited about it.
All they had to go on was a description by famous naturalist Edward Cope, written in 1870. He described a full-bodied fish he named Tychostomus robustus, but the specimen disappeared.
Cope described 11 species or so of suckers. After that was published, that was the last anyone had heard of a fish named robust anything that was a sucker.
The robustus name was mistakenly given to another sucker. However, this fat fellow was a much better match. Freeman found pharyngeal teeth in a specimen. That means teeth in the throat, used to crush prey like small mussels. Now they had something. And another thing. In his 1870 description, Cope wrote about an unusual mouth.
Well, the central part of the lip has got this thing that hangs back. It's like a little sole patch on the bottom of his lip. And that's another diagnostic characteristic. And he mentions that as medial prolongation. And just like, my God, this is it. It fits exactly.
The robustus species Cope described, thought to be extinct for 120 years, was alive and swimming in Georgia's Oconee River. A young Jimmy Evans was thrust into the limelight.
In the United States, they range in length from 6 to about 30 inches. This is one of the largest species of redhorse right here. It feeds on a wide variety of plant and animal material. The group does generally. This particular fish feeds on clams, mussels, and snails, which it has large pharyngeal teeth that it uses to grind up the shells with. This particular fish is believed to be one of the rarest fish in North America, certainly one of the rarest large fish.
They gave this fish a new name, robust red horse. Exciting news, but then trouble. The fish in the Oconee River were old, with very few young fish to replace them.
Just by accident, and that's all you can say, by accident, we happened to catch this fish when we had time to do something about it. We had, we were thinking, and there were a lot of discussions about how long is this population going to last, and we were beginning to think the possibility that it could disappear. As these older fish die off, a few younger fish to replace, this could disappear. So we determined that that something had to be done about it, and it was pretty urgent.
They collected fish and used their eggs and sperm to create a stock population. Those small fish were released more than a decade ago and helped boost wild populations in Georgia. Other natural populations were found on the Savannah and PD rivers. Now the robust movement has spread to South and North Carolina. Jimmy takes me to see how the recovery of this special fish has expanded well beyond the Oconee River. We pull up to a gravel bar in the middle of Savannah River, where biologist Forrest Sessions and his crew from South Carolina get ready to catch robust red horse as they spawn.
See, this out here is more sand substrate. That's gravel. I hope you got that on film.
Hope not.
This is a small world, the Red Horse people. And Jimmy, though he's a humble guy, takes pride in the fact that his discovery in 1991 is resulting in more stable populations today.
You see what they're doing? The males are establishing dominance. They're establishing a position on the gravel bar and maintaining it. And the smaller males, the subdominant ones, are trying to push him away. And so there's a constant battle down there between the dominant and subdominant males.
These gravel bars in the springtime act like magnets.
Oh, there's one just went over the bar. They're right there. They're all over, right in here. I suggest we put, we're going to put one here and one just upstream there, too.
The crew has bars that form a square, and when the electric generator is plugged into that cord, anything inside will get a shock.
I think we're ready. We're just waiting on fish now.
Isn't that always the case?
Always the case. Always the case.
Always be waiting on some
waiting on
fish somewhere.
But at least we're out here today.
Yeah.
When it happens, everyone needs to be in place. The water is moving fast, and robust red horse don't float to the top like other species. They come up for a second and then go back down. It begins. Like a scene in a sci-fi movie where the good guys are trying to capture a flesh-eating monster, biologists crouch and brace against the rapids to snare one of the most secretive species in North America.
I think there was a couple in
front. Oh, man, that's a good one. That looks like a female species.
That's a female I got right here.
Fantastic.
Well, I got a boy. You got a female, Brian?
I think that's the male.
That's two females. Brian's got a female. I've got a female.
Yeah, no, I've got a male.
One male, two females.
It's a little better run.
Yeah.
Got six, I think.
You got a male?
Looks like a little male.
we can get one more male, we can make six crosses. We got two females and three males.
And how many? That'll get you 100.
We'll be over 100. That's right.
And they go back out for more.
Three.
To protect the genetic pool, they need several males and at least 2 to 3 females.
Stay low. Stay low.
An assembly line begins as they dry the fish, then push sperm from the males. It is kept on ice in vials and can be used on more than one female. The females are full of eggs, and coaxing them out is just a matter of putting pressure on the belly.
There we go. That's what we're looking for. Once you get that first shot, it's just about it.
This is an all-day process. Shock, collect, measure, and weigh. In addition, a snip of one fin is taken for DNA identification.
Come here and feel this fin. You know, fish normally feel slimy. Mm-hmm. Feel this.
Oh, you want to put that one in there?
Oh, my God. Okay.
See how dry she is?
Yes.
And normally, when they're not in spawning condition, they're real slimy. The advantage, obviously, when they're dry like that is when they get in that spawning triad and there's two males on the outside of the female and they're pushing against each other, if they were still real slimy, they would just slide off one another, all right?
Wow.
But being dry like that, they're able to
get a little more
friction.
It feels like rubber.
Yeah, it does.
What looks like acne is called nuptial tubercles, only found on males. It is believed to be a signal to females. More tubercles may represent a superior male. They could also be used in battles to determine dominance. The spawning itself is wild. Watch as the female is flanked by two guys. They bump into her, releasing the eggs, then fertilize them in the gravel. But this may be part of the reason their population dropped so low. When spawning, the red horse is like a sitting duck. Native Americans and settlers almost certainly caught massive numbers of the fish. And much of the river gravel they need to spawn was eventually covered with silt.
They've survived, European settlers coming in and clearing the landscape. There's a great quote of Sir Charles Lyell, visited North America in the 1800s. And he got to the junction on the Altamaha of the Okmulgee and Oconee Rivers. And he said, you can see on which land the hand of the white man lay, because the Oconee River ran red with mud, and the Okmulgee was clear and still in Indian hands. And so those changes happened overnight. So, we've seen a landscape that's changed, and it's not what it was. And it probably won't be what it was. So we're living in managed landscapes now.
To show you why gravel is so important to the red horse, we used red lumpfish eggs. When dropped on gravel, they fall into the crevices. And in the wild, they would be fertilized, have clean water, oxygen, and enough microorganisms to eat until they're large enough to swim out. Now, put sand or silt over the gravel and watch what happens. There's no protection. Eggs that may find a depression in the gravel will smother, and others would eventually get swept away. Back on the Savannah River gravel bar, robust redhorse eggs are being fertilized. It's just that simple. A turkey feather, some water, a few swishes, and the eggs are fertilized and ready to go to an incubation facility. Months later, we meet up with Forrest Sessions again at a hatchery center near Charleston, South Carolina.
We brought those eggs back here to South Carolina. We incubated them, hatched them out, and then stocked the larvae when they were probably about 2 weeks. They were about this size, and we stocked them into the ponds then.
So these are our babies.
these are our babies that we produced in May.
Georgia began the process. Now, South Carolina is about to wrap up their restocking effort. As the canal behind us drains, all the baby redhorse are pushed into a small concrete pen. Crowds of ibis snatch up other kinds of fish and tadpoles that are left behind. As they pull the net for their first haul, the numbers look amazing.
Yeah, wow. Great numbers.
Bucket after bucket of tiny, robust redhorse. It is hard to believe all these babies came from a handful of fish and one day on the Savannah River.
But I'm thinking we're going to have 3,000 fish out of this pond.
There are more than that. And a second pond is draining that will bear additional fish.
Well, this is great.
I'm tickled. I'm tickled. I'm always a little nervous when, especially when we got something special like today, that we're going to have a good harvest. But it worked out well.
That's so great. Yeah, I could tell when that first batch came up.
That's right.
Inside, there are holding pens, and the fish will stay there until they're transported to their new homes in South Carolina. They will be taken to three rivers where skeletal remains of redhorse teeth were found in Indian mounds. Even at this size, they are showing the red tail. Many of the fish released are injected with a pit tag, more like a pin. It carries an ID number, so other biologists who catch the same fish will report back, and all involved parties can track migration patterns. The fins are clipped and preserved to provide DNA. Any fish that has been stocked can be identified from those samples, and researchers will be able to determine the mother and father of that fish and where it came from. This is the last time South Carolina will stock. Now, North Carolina is continuing the process.
So, Forrest, how important was Jimmy Evans to this whole process?
First professional biologist to ever catch one, in the modern era or whatever, that had the foresight to know that he had something he had never seen before and knew that he needed to investigate it and see what exactly had. And then once they discovered what they had, the foresight and the vision to make it a priority, and not only a priority within just Georgia DNR, but they included the power companies, they included the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, included South Carolina DNR. And now, it's a multi-agency, committee. The Robust Redhorse Conservation Committee, consists of North Carolina, wildlife people, Fish and Wildlife Service, South Carolina, Georgia, Duke Power, Progress Energy, SE&G, Georgia Power, the universities, you know, at University of Georgia, all those, and I'm maybe missing some, hopefully not, but, you know, all those agencies and those organizations now, you know, with a common goal, you know, of restoring and making this fish, you know, not imperiled, because it was, you know, obviously very imperiled, you know, fish on, you know, the brink of disappearing.
All that from quiet Jimmy Evans.
From quiet Jimmy Evans, that's right, unassuming Jimmy.
You may be thinking, but really? All this for a fish we didn't know existed anyway?
We are the state agency, the Georgia Department of Natural Resources. We are responsible for, you know, the legacy of the state's natural resources. I mean, North Georgia has a great heritage of natural resources, and we're the stewards of that. And the citizens of Georgia have basically hired us and given us a responsibility to safeguard those natural resources, that natural heritage, and the robust redhorse is a part of that, a big part of the legacy of our natural environment. So we all felt, you know, a tremendous responsibility to work as hard as we could to bring this fish back. And I've got to say that back in 1991, when we discovered this population was in trouble, and it began to dawn on us that this is our responsibility. We have to do something, and nobody else is going to do it but us.
I'll tell you a little story about that. So biologists have got stories. We were processing one of the first robust redhorse that we had collected, one of the first few, from the Oconee River, and we stayed over in Milledgeville, and we got a room on the back side of the Holiday Inn. And an angler stumbled out of the room next door. He was drinking a beer. He was into his cups, they say. And he looked down and said, "My God, that's an ugly fish. What good is it?" And my friend from Florida, Noel Burkhead, said, "Well, what good are you?" He said, "Dang, you've got a good point there." Now, I don't know if I answered your question or not, but I answered it with a story. And I've used that little vignette a lot, and it gets people to thinking about, hey, what good am I? I mean, what is the value in all this? A diverse assemblage of animals living in these ecosystems tells us something about the habitat. I mean, this is sort of a canned answer, but if these things are living in the water, then the water quality is probably good.
To fish ecologist Bud Freeman, the rediscovered redhorse begs the question, how much have we lost that we don't even know about? Jimmy Evans has a different take. What else is out there?
In the water? Hiding in the forest? Deep in a swamp? What other species is waiting to be discovered?
I've been working with this fish for, you know, over 20 years, and it still amazes me every time I look at this fish. How could a fish this large and this distinctive have existed in not one but three rivers in the Southeast for over 100 years undetected? It's perhaps there are some reasons, reasons you could explain how that could have occurred, but still it's a mystery. And I've heard people call this a mystery fish, and, you know, I think that's probably, you know, appropriate term for it, the mystery fish.
Okay.
Ready to go.
Back out to the gravel spawning bar. There she goes.
There's something to be said for a species that can exist for more than a century without us even knowing it's there. Any way you cut it, the robust redhorse is one heck of a fish. I'm Sharon Collins. We'll see you next time.
Thank you.
Funding for Georgia Outdoors has been made possible in part by grants from the Georgia Natural Resources Foundation, from the Imlay Foundation, and from viewers like you.